Anamorphic on a budget? This is real. Suray, yeah, that's the right pronunciation of this company name, 50mm, 24mm and 35mm, which is shooting me right now, is a pretty outstanding option for you videographers all over the world. Let's go. What's good, guys? My name is Oleg Nikitin and you're watching No Limits On and my Tech Kitchen. And today we're having an in-depth review and comparison basically among those three lenses, anamorphic lenses from Suray company. And actually I went to Turkey, to Cappadocia, to one of the most beautiful places on the planet Earth, and I shot a couple of great shots on three different weddings. So here are some shots. And if you want to see the full version, it's here, link is right there in the YouTube card and down in the description below. So let's talk in detail about those lenses. First, let's talk about what's in the box. In the box we get this pretty nice pouch, which is made out of velvet, I guess. Also we have here the front cap and the rear cap. And that's it for the 24 and for 50mm, but for the 35mm lens we also get the rings for your follow focus system, for your aperture ring and for your focus ring. So it's a pretty nice kit, I guess, and we're moving on. Oh, and one more thing to mention, that the 35mm lens comes only in Micro Four Thirds mount, but the others come in different mounts, like native mounts for Sony E mount, for Fuji, for Nikon Z mount also, but the 35mm comes only in Micro Four Thirds, but it has some adapter rings. So I bought an, not bought, actually they gave me for a review, a store in Russia gave me for a review, a special adapter ring for Sony E mount, and then just screw it on, I screwed everything up and screwed it on. And I used this 35mm, which is shooting me right now, on my Sony A7S III, which is a full frame camera. We'll talk about it in a second. But I was able to shoot even in 4K with this lens and with this camera. Now let's talk about the size and weight. Those lenses are not that heavy for anamorphics, because anamorphic lenses tend to have a lot of weight and a lot of size in those lenses. This is the heaviest lens, 24mm f2.8, and it weighs 780 grams. The 35mm, which is shooting me right now, weighs 700 grams. And 50mm lens weighs only 590 grams. So those are not that heavy for anamorphics. And I was able to bring those three lenses with me, together with the camera, with Atomos Ninja 5, which is also a necessary tool, or some kind of a monitor, we'll talk about it in a minute. And I was able to bring even the Mavic 2 Pro from DJI to my trip to Turkey, to Cappadocia. And I had only the backpack with me, so I got everything I wanted there. Those lenses are made for APS-C or Super 35 or Micro Four Thirds sensors, but I was using it on my Sony A7S III, which is a full frame camera. I was using it in 4K mode and I was using the clear image zoom with 1.4 magnification. I have assigned the button, which is the trash can button, to be the clear image zoom, so I hit this button and then I hit upwards on the dial and it makes it 1.4, just the exact number that I need, so it wasn't a hassle anymore, not at all. The image is still very nice and crisp, and this 4K mode with clear image zoom is totally workable. To properly monitor your picture you need a D-squeeze. And actually you need a monitor to do this, or a camera that can do this, like Panasonic GH5 for instance. So you get a monitor, and like Atomos Ninja 5 that I was using and I'm using right now, to actually properly view and see and you know, judge focus and to overall work with the picture. And I had the D-squeeze for 1.4 1.33. So this is the anamorphic squeeze ratio, 1.33, and I apply the same D squeeze in my monitor. And I was judging the focus, I was seeing the better picture, and I was seeing the end result. And in post, I simply go to the width in the scale tab and I enter 133% for the scale, and it just de-squeezes the picture, and it has some quirks. I'll talk about those in a minute. And now about focusing itself. The focusing ring is very smooth and it has around 180 degrees of rotation, and the aperture ring is pretty well dampened and it's very, very smooth and precise, so it's just a joy to use, and the whole build quality of all of three of those Suray lenses is on par. It's a great build quality and those lenses can be workhorses for years for you. And by the way, those lenses do not come with a lens hood, so if you want some kind of a lens hood, you have to make it DIY, and you know, it is what it is. If you use some anamorphic adapters, it was a pain to use because you had to set dual focus for the plane of focus of your anamorphic adapter and then for your normal lens, and it was just a pain. And those lenses from Suray you can use just as a regular photography lens. Just scroll the focus wheel, the focus ring, and focus as you regularly do with your manual lenses. Speaking of aperture, 50mm and 35mm both have 1.8 aperture. It's a pretty bright aperture, and you can even shoot in a very low light situation, especially with the Sony a7S III. So those lenses are actually built for low light, if you wish, and if you will. And the 24mm has 2.8 aperture. It's not that bright, but still it's a pretty bright lens, and I'm very satisfied with it. I have to mention that all three lenses are very sharp indeed on the wide aperture. So f1.8 is a pretty sharp aperture for both of the 50 and 35mm, and f2.8 is a pretty workable aperture for 24mm. That's pretty good. And if we talk about anamorphic characteristics and overall anamorphic look, the 24 has the least anamorphic look in my opinion than 35, and the most amount of, you know, oval bokehs and the flaring and all that stuff has the 50mm lens. Maybe it's because of the compression of the depth of field, you know, it's more pronounced, but still this is the most kind of anamorphic looking lens and the picture. So the picture from 50mm lens is the most anamorphic looking, for me at least, but 35 is also a very nice addition, and the wide angle anamorphic on 24 is also pronounced, but not that much. And now about flares. We all know that anamorphic picture is always associated with flares. Some, you know, epic blue all over the screen flares like Michael Bay movies or whatever. So the 24mm has pretty thin but very long flare, like along the frame, all over the place. And it's very flary, and you can basically see those flares on the footage I'm showing you. It's a nice flare, but it's a little thin to me. The 35mm, on the other hand, often provides you with two more widthy, more fat flares, and those flares are fading towards the edges of the picture. Very nice flaring actually from the 35mm, I do prefer those flares a lot. And the 50mm is overall a more cool looking picture. It provides us with a cooler picture overall, and the flares are a little more cool towards blue and cyan, and it's pretty flary also, and I do enjoy the flares from the 50mm as well. All three lenses produce pretty nice flares, and you can definitely say that it was shot on anamorphic. Speaking of color rendition, 24mm and 35mm are pretty close in terms of color and picture, but instead the 50mm is way cooler. So I had to change my white balance almost all the time I put on the 50mm lens, and it was around 300 to 400 Kelvin all around. And now guys, the most interesting part, but also the most disappointing part about those lenses. The anamorphic squeeze ratio is not constant. It's not always 1.33. Sometimes it gets even to 1.25 in my, you know, observation. This happens because not all of the lens is made out of anamorphic elements. Basically, this part of the lens is made out of spherical elements, and only this part is made out of anamorphic elements. I'll have a link down in the description below for two great videos about anamorphic lenses. And there you can see in detail the process of the constructing anamorphic lenses and why they changed the squeeze ratio. It means that we get 1.33 when we at infinity focus, but as soon as we get to a close focus, we can get around 1.26, 1.27, 1.25 even anamorphic squeeze ratio. It means that your faces in the shot, when you shoot like up close with minimal focusing distance, they will be much fatter and more stretched out, and you will have to apply a little less de-squeeze, not 1.33 in the width of your scale, but for instance 1.25 or 1.27, and you'll look at the screen and you'll decide by yourself whether it's a normal face or it's too stretched out or too squeezed up. It's a negative, of course, but for this price and this weight and size, it was a compromise, pretty good compromise actually. So if you do want to shoot with those lenses, you have to be ready to work in post a lot more to choose the right squeeze factor for your shots. And now let's talk about minimal focusing distance. The minimal focusing distance is always a weak spot of the anamorphic lenses, and those lenses from Suray are not an exception. So the minimal focusing distance of 24mm is 60 centimeters, of 35 and 50mm is 85 centimeters. So it's a pretty good distance, and you cannot make a pretty close-up shot with it, but you can buy some diopters. They are screwed onto the front of the lens and they are basically working like glasses for your lens, and you can focus much closer, but you'll lose the infinity. So you'll be screwing it on and screwing it off all the time when you need a much more closer focus. And also those lenses are with 67mm thread, the 50mm and the 35mm. They both have a 67mm thread, a pretty common one. And the 24mm is a little bigger. It has 72mm filter thread. And about focus breathing. Those three lenses are not having issues with focus breathing. 24 and 50mm are handling focus breathing brilliantly, and 35mm is a little worse, but still it's a pretty great performance. It won't affect your videos a lot, even if you do like a focus rack from infinity to the closest focusing distance, but you'll need to notice that your squeeze ratio may change, and you can set some keyframes for your picture so it's not kind of, de-squeezing and squeezing while you're rec focusing. And now about stabilization. Those lenses for sure do not have built-in image stabilization, of course, but I do have image stabilization in IBIS, in camera image stabilization on the Sony a7S III, but it doesn't work correctly. Even though I set the correct, focal length and millimeters inside the camera manually, it doesn't work properly. So I was holding it pretty strong and still, and I saw some floating from the sensor, and it's not what I want. Also, I tried the active steady shot, and it also doesn't work, at least for me. I wasn't expecting this much, floating from it. And the catalyst browse gyro data is not existent when you use those lenses, because the camera needs to have some electronic connection to the lens so it understands the focal length. And when I recorded some clips with the steady shot off and put those clips into Catalyst Browse with those Suray lenses, I didn't have the gyro data at all. So basically you'll need to use a Steadicam, a gimbal or a monopod or a tripod or super steady hands like I did, and stabilizing post. I have stabilized all of the clips in Final Cut Pro, no warp stabilizer or something, just built-in Final Cut Pro stabilizers, and it worked pretty nicely. So guys, now I'm gonna tell you my impressions about all three lenses, the benefits, the prices, and all that stuff. So the 24mm is f2.8, and it's a pretty dark lens comparing to those 250 and 35mm, but still it's a pretty nice lens, it's rather fast, and it has pretty nice flaring, those stripes of blue lights, looking great. Also, it is the heaviest and it's the biggest lens and the priciest also. It costs $1,000 and it's a pretty big price for an anamorphic, like amateurish lens, let me say. But it does provide you with pretty sharp and outstanding picture quality, and it's just a joy to use. Unfortunately, it has a bigger filter thread, not the same as those anamorphic lenses. So if you buy, for instance, some diopters, you cannot put it onto here. You have to buy it separately, and the separate set of, you know, adapter rings or something to use your filters on this lens. But let me say that the anamorphic picture on a wide angle lens looks amazing. Actually, I've enjoyed the 35mm the most because it's, you know, the best focal length, at least for me. You can take a wide shot, you can take a close-up shot. It has f1.8 aperture, so you can use it basically everywhere, even at night. Also, you can use it to blur the background more and to make your anamorphic look more pronounced, which is great. And the build quality is great. The focusing ring, the aperture ring for your follow focus, your interchangeable mount, also a great option. And the price is $800. Pretty great value for money, I guess. If I was buying only one lens from this kit, I would buy the 35mm for sure. And the 50mm lens is the smallest, the lightest lens, but it has a drawback because it provides you with a much cooler picture and you have to do a lot of work in post or during shooting to match this 50mm with other two Suray lenses. Also, it provides you with great picture quality, pretty sharp f1.8 aperture. Just a great lens to start with because it's the least amount of money. It costs only $700, which is a nice amount of cash for this type of lens. And I've enjoyed some close-up shots with it, and the anamorphic bokeh, you know, those ovals are more pronounced on this lens. So guys, the conclusion. Those three lenses from Suray are a pretty good and nice step towards anamorphic shooting if you're just trying, you know, it for the first time. Because 1.33 anamorphic squeeze and ratio is not the best and not the most pronounced one. Of course, 1.8 or X2 anamorphic will provide you with much, much stronger anamorphic effect and you'll see it much better, but those lenses are way, way pricier and way bigger. So for the beginners, if you want to try it out, this is a great solution. And you guys, please share your thoughts in the comment section below. What do you think about Suray anamorphic lenses, 24, 35, 50mm? And if you did like the content on my channel, please smash the like and subscribe buttons, as I say in my videos, and hit the notifications bell also. This was Oleg Nikitin, my Tech Kitchen, and No Limits On channel. See you in the next video, guys. Take care. Bye.